Greetings to all of you, and welcome to the King's Corner with myself, Brother Klaus, and Brother Marcus. And today we want to talk to you about something that's very vital in our walks with God as we pursue our calling, and that is the rejection test. God has plans for every single one of our lives, and He has a purpose, something that He wants all of us to accomplish. There's a place of destiny that God is wanting to take each and every one of us to, and that journey requires some testing. The Bible says in Jeremiah 29:11, "For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, saith the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end." God has a plan for your life, and He wants to take you somewhere beautiful and somewhere powerful. Consider Joseph of the Old Testament. Joseph received a dream from God in the very beginning of his life. He was 17 years old, and God gave him a dream revealing to him that he was going to be a ruler. That's a big, big dream. And He gave him two of them to validate that this was from God. So Joseph knew that he was going to rule and that he was going to have people bowing to him, people that he was going to oversee. God showed him what he was going to do. But Joseph didn't know that there was a rigorous process that he was going to have to endure. And that was the rejection test. Joseph was rejected by his brothers, and they didn't like the idea of Joseph ruling over them. They thought that he was maybe arrogant or maybe a spoiled little brat. And Joseph was rejected by his brothers. They planned on murdering him. And instead, they ended up selling him into Egypt as a slave. And there, Joseph suffered rejection. He was the son of a powerful man, Jacob, but he was rejected. And he was a son in the house of Jacob, and now he's become a servant of Potiphar. He went from a high status in society to a very low status of society. And I can only imagine what he began to think about as he was experiencing this rough part of his life. Hey, God said that He was going to use me. God showed me in a dream that I was going to be a powerful ruler. And maybe Joseph had it figured out that, you know, I'm going to grow up under my father's house. My father's going to give me authority over my brothers and the entire family. And maybe Joseph's idea of how he was going to get to the place of destiny was a lot different than how God was going to do that. And God allowed Joseph to be rejected, severely rejected. Not only was he rejected by his own family, but he was rejected by the people that he served. And the Bible tells us that he did a great job serving. He served Potiphar. He was in charge of everything that Potiphar had, and he did an excellent job, and he found favor. And then he got into trouble because he was resisting temptation with Potiphar's wife, and the things got very bad. She ended up calling the guards on him and accused him of something falsely that he didn't do. Many of us know how the story goes. So Joseph goes from a good place to a bad place to an even worse place. Now, instead of just being a slave in the house of Potiphar, now Joseph has become a prisoner. Joseph was a prisoner of the promise. He had a promise from God that God was going to use him as a ruler, that God was going to use him as an overseer. But before God allowed him to experience that, he had Joseph go through the rejection test. Would Joseph still serve God, even though by all appearances he was utterly abandoned? He tested him with Potiphar's wife to see if Joseph would forsake his God. And Joseph's reason for not doing it is, how can I sin against my God? How can I do this thing against the God that I serve? Joseph maintained his integrity all the while he was rejected. The Bible shows no indication that he struggled with bitterness or resentment. The Bible doesn't show that part. He didn't blame God for the bad things that happened. How many of you know oftentimes when something bad happens, on your way to fulfill your purpose, you get mad, you get upset? And sometimes we can even come to the place where we blame God. Well, God, this is your fault. I'm trying to do your work, and you allowed this bad thing to happen that set me back. Joseph's situation was a huge setback. He became a slave, and he became a prisoner. But what he didn't know was that he was a prisoner of the promise. And Joseph was being tested through these series of rejections. Even though he was rejected, God preserved him and kept him in the place until Joseph passed all of the tests. And at the end of Joseph's rejection test, Joseph was immediately elevated, instantaneously, overnight. His road downward was gradual. He went from being at home to being in Potiphar's house to being in the dungeon. He went from high to low on a gradual scale. But when God got ready to elevate him, his elevation was instantaneous. His elevation was explosive. And in a similar manner, when God gives us a great destiny, we have to pass the rejection test. Will we still live for God if things don't go the way that we think they should go? And that's a big test for us.
Yes, without passing the rejection test, there's no way that you can get promoted in the kingdom. In John 1:11, it says, "He came unto his own, and his own received him not." This was one of the big things that God had to deal with me about. You might ask, well, why do I have to pass the rejection test? God will have you go through the rejection test so you stop looking to people to be the source of your joy. So you stop looking to people to be the source of your promotion, the source of you going to the next level. The Bible says, I open doors that no man can shut. And quite often we fall into this trap. Well, if I can just get close to so-and-so, the door is going to be open for me. If I can just get this person to like me, the door is going to be open for me. If I could just get into the clique with the pastor, if I can just get into the clique with the church. Let me tell you something, my brothers and sisters, my whole life, I've pretty much been rejected in church. Never was the cool guy, never was accepted. I was always like on the outskirts, never on the inside. But I'll be honest, at first I used to get a little bit bitter about it. And then you question yourself. This is how the enemy uses it. When you're in that rejected phase, the enemy starts talking to you. Well, why don't they like me? Why don't they accept me? Why don't they see that I'm gifted? Why don't they see the good things about me? And you might start feeling like you've got some kind of sickness. But there's two reasons that God will reject you or allow you to be rejected. He will allow you to be rejected, number one, because the people that you want to get involved with, God knows more than you know. He sees more than you see. And if he allows you to get connected to those people, you will be corrupted. Not necessarily because those individuals are bad for you, but their acceptance will cause you to move into this place of comfort where he cannot do what he wants to do in you. So if Joseph's brothers had accepted him, it would have never developed the character that Joseph needed to have developed in him. See, every step of the way Joseph managed the situation he was in, and he managed it in a way that God was building his character step by step. So through the rejection, look what the Bible says. If this happened to Jesus, if he went to his own, as wonderful as he was, and even his own people wanted to crucify him, and we claim to be followers of Christ, why is it that we think that we can avoid rejection? The Bible, in fact, says, Luke 6:22, "Blessed are ye when men shall hate you, and when they shall separate you from their company and shall reproach you and cast out your name as evil for the Son of Man's sake." It literally says that you are blessed. And watch this, Matthew 10:14, "And whosoever shall not receive you, nor hear your words, when ye depart out of the house of the city, shake off the dust from your feet." That's passing the test right there. Sometimes people are just not going to receive you. They're not going to accept you. And you have to stop looking for people to cheer you on, because if you live for their applause, you'll die by their silence. You'll think that, man, maybe I'm not anointed. Maybe I'm not called to preach because they've never given me an opportunity to preach. Maybe I'm not called to teach. Maybe I'm not called to be married. Maybe nobody will ever love me. And so that's how the enemy will use the rejection. But God uses the rejection to see if you're going to trust him. Lord, these people are not cheering me on. I'm out here by myself. I'm out here all alone. You've called me to do something. You've told me to do something, and nobody else believes it. Matter of fact, Everything that I seem to do, people come against it. Everything that I do, people critique it. Everything that I do, everything that you've called me to say, people always find a problem with it, and they never have something good to say. Every thought that I have, every dream that I have, people tell me that I'm wrong. What the Lord is looking for is, if I gave you the dream, if I gave you the word, if I gave you the vision, why is that not enough? Why do you need other people to co-sign on the dream that I gave you? Why do you need other people to co-sign on the vision and the word and the direction that I gave you? Even if you read the story of Moses, God kind of got frustrated with Moses when he was talking to Moses. And he said, look, Aaron is coming. Aaron is on the way. But you could clearly see if you read it that God was like, what is the problem? I've already told you what to do. I've already told you how I'm going to do it. I've already showed you certain things, but yet and still, you're looking for a co-signer. God says, I am your co-signer. I've stamped you. I've validated you. I've loved you. Why is the love of God not enough in our lives? It gets to the point where we make relationships an idol. And if a man or a woman rejects us, whether it's in a relationship aspect or from a, someone we're looking up to aspect, we get crushed by it. But why, when the reality is he's loved us with an everlasting love? The love that you can get from God, the validation that you can get from God is so much greater than anything that the world can give you. Look at this verse right here. It says, when my father and my mother forsake me, this is Psalms 27:10, then the Lord will take me up. You know what the problem really is? Is we don't appreciate God's love. We don't appreciate what he can do for us, and we don't really believe it. We believe that I'll be happier if I can have this relationship. I'll be happier if I can have this person's validation. And the Lord, quite frankly, he has feelings. The Bible says he's a jealous God, and people don't talk about this often, but he will allow you to be in a place where you stay getting rejected. You stay in the wilderness and never make it to the promised land because he's saying you've made people an idol. You've made their approval an idol in your life. You won't step off the boat until the other apostles co-sign and say, we'll step with you. And God is saying, no. I gave you a word and I told you to step out. I didn't tell you to look to the left and look to the right and ask Andrew and ask John, hey, are you guys going to step with me? Hey, guys, cheer me on. Cheer me on when I step off this boat. Same thing with David. People could have, you know, if he was looking for people's validation, man, oh, Goliath is going to destroy you. No, he stepped out without cheerleaders. Can you step out when people are doubting you? Can you step out when people are trying to assassinate your dream and the only wow. thing you have to stand on is the fact that God has validated me? The world can reject me. The world can think that everything that I'm doing is wrong, but God has validated me. They often ask, you know, by whose authority do you baptize? God validated me. I don't need your approval. I don't need your certificate. It's good to get these things. But it's not good to idolize it. We're going to get a little bit more deep into that because it gets deep being rejected by man and trying to live according to man's standard and man's will for your life. Matter of fact, you might have to do some rejection. You might have to start rejecting the things that people are saying, rejecting the will of men. But we're going to get into that when we get back.
Greetings, everyone. We're so glad that you joined us here at the King's Corner with myself, Brother Klaus, and my brother Marcus. It's a delight for us to be here with you to share from the Word of God. And today, we've been talking about the rejection test. Many of us oftentimes feel we're in a situation where we're being rejected, but there's a purpose behind that. So stay tuned as we talk about more.
Welcome back to the King's Corner. Brother Marcus here with my brother Klaus. And today we're talking about the test of rejection, the rejection test. Now, one of the things that we read, I want to bring it back very quickly. All right. In Matthew 10:14, it talks about shaking the dust off your feet if they don't receive you. And so, in a sense, we've got to start learning to do some rejecting of our own. We've got to reject some people's opinions. We've got to reject when people say things that go against what God has showed you. And the example that I always like to use, right, is King Saul with his armor when he tried to put it on David. Now, if David had stepped out in King Saul's armor to fight Goliath, he probably would have got destroyed, okay? And what often happens is when you're in the battles of this life, everybody has an opinion. They have an opinion on how you should deal with your marriage. They have an opinion on how you should do your ministry. And if I was in your position, I wouldn't do this and I wouldn't do that. But quite often they're not in your shoes, so they don't know and they don't see. So having some balance in your life is learning when not to be so insecure that you just let people run over you, but when to reject certain things. I can't put on Saul's armor. I can't put on your opinions when I go fight Goliath. I've got to stand in what God told me. So David, when he went to fight Goliath, he realized, look, all I need is what has worked for me. And what has worked for him when he fought the bear, when he fought the lion, was the fact, number one, that God was with him, the presence of God was with him, and he had the stones, all right, and he had the sling. Many people looking at David going to fight Goliath would say, that's completely unwise. You need to take this sword. You need to take this shield. How do you apply that to your life? Well, you need to do this in your marriage, and you need to do this in your ministry, and you need to do this in your church. And so if you suffer, all right, from that spirit of rejection, you will bow down to people's opinions instead of standing for the will of God in your life. And that is a very dangerous thing. Bowing down to this idol, this spirit of wanting to be accepted, you've got to learn when it's time to put your foot down, regardless of if anybody supports you or not, and they're laughing at you and they're saying, hey, David, you're a real fool going out there fighting Goliath without that armor. You got to know that I'm doing this the way that God, and not to be bold and not to be arrogant, but spirit-led. And here's the thing with the enemy. The enemy knows how to hurt you. He's watching you, and he is observing you, and he knows what buttons to press. He knows that, okay, you might not respond a certain way when somebody at your job says something. But, oh, I saw that when your mother or your wife or your husband said that, it really affected you. It really crushed you. Mm-hmm. So he will try to use people around. And you have to realize that that individual is not the enemy. All right. We wrestle not against flesh and blood. Sometimes, whether they know it or not, the enemy might just be using them to cut you, to hurt you, so you can feel rejected. And I learned this many years ago. This is something that the Lord showed me. I was praying and I said, Lord, man, why don't people see what you showed me? Why aren't people accepting me? And he said, look, I wanted them to reject you. And he said, please understand this. They are not a bad person because they rejected you. It's not that they're not Holy Spirit filled or Holy Spirit led. The Lord, in his wisdom, will blind people to seeing certain things. I honestly believe that the Lord allowed Joseph's brother to be blinded. He could have showed them. He could have gave them a dream. He could have gave them some kind of revelation that was so clear that they couldn't doubt it. But Joseph had to go through a process. So here's the thing. Here's the wisdom aspect of it. Don't get caught up in your feelings when people reject you. Don't get caught up when people are not excited about the vision or excited about the dream that God gave you, because the Lord doesn't want their acceptance and their cheers to be the fuel to your fire or the fuel that makes your vehicle go. Because what do you do as soon as they're not passionate about it? So the Lord, what he will do is he wants the fuel to your vehicle to be just his validation. You're going to go because he told you to go. You're going to stand because he told you to stand. You're going to be faithful because you believe in God, not because people are accepting you, praising you, are clapping. And I'm going to give it to my brother Klaus, but one thing I'll say, there's even been times where I've preached and I didn't feel it, okay? And the enemy will even use that. You're not always going to feel it. And that's what rejection really does. It's all about my feelings. I want to feel accepted. I want to feel validated. Your feelings will deceive you. And that's why it's important to stand on the word of God and the validation of God and not how you feel.
Yeah. Science has shown us that every human being is born with this basic need to belong. If you study the social sciences, there's plenty of research that shows that people have a need to belong. They have to feel like they're a part of something. They have to feel like they belong. So when we come into the world and we don't have that place of belonging, which really our parents is supposed to provide, our parents are supposed to be that safe place. Our parents are supposed to raise up with the concept of belonging and love. And when we don't get that already, we find ourselves at a disadvantage with this root of rejection, with this spirit of rejection. When that happens, the enemy comes in and begins to say things to us like, you are not worthy, you're unwanted, you are messed up, you're unlovable, nobody wants you. And he'll point to the facts of life to support his argument. And how can you argue with that? If your mom left you and the devil says you're no good and the evidence is your mom left you and that's proof that you're no good, what kid isn't going to believe that? If your father isn't around and the devil comes to tell you, see, it's because you're not a good kid, you're just a bad kid, that's why your dad's not around, what kid isn't going to believe that? We're all gonna eat that up. So we come up with this disadvantage already feeling rejected. Now, a lot of us in that state, we strive to be accepted. We go out of our way somehow to perform excellently, and the intention is, I want to be accepted. Some of us become workaholics. We want to excel at the job so that we can receive that acceptance. Oh, you did a good job, and we derive our self-worth from that. Some of us, instead of becoming workaholics, we become alcoholics. We want to drink until we feel good, until we drown out the misery of the rejection. It's about the intention of the heart. Our motives can be so blinded, so skewed with this pain of rejection that everything that we do is a feeble attempt to feel that love and that acceptance. And in some cases, with us believers, when we deal with that, God has to take us through a strenuous process of rejection. God will allow us to feel rejected. And it's not even that people are rejecting us on purpose, as Marcus was saying. We've been shaped with this worldview of that we are rejected, we're no good. Consequently, this becomes a lens, the way that we see life. We see life as rejection. So when someone says something to us or does something, their intent might have been innocent. They might not have meant anything by it. But because we've been wounded with rejection, our worldview is stained with rejection. And everything that happens to us, we perceive as, I'm being rejected, I'm being rejected. And that's not a good way to live, because our motive then becomes, I have to go out of my way to be accepted. When I was a teenager, I struggled with that. I wanted to be accepted. And I did almost anything that I could to feel that accept. I would smoke cigarettes, run away from home, sneak out of the house at night, hang out late, hang out with the wrong crowd, listen to the wrong music. Whatever the in crowd was doing, whatever I had to do to fit in, I did that. I did whatever I had to. If I had to smoke weed to fit in, I did that. If I had to run away to fit in, I did that. Wherever I could fit in. Unfortunately, it was with the wrong crowd. Some of you were fortunate not to fit in with people like that, but you fit in with the sports guys. Whatever you had to do to excel at sports, you'd stay at practice. You'd do everything excessively to make sure that you get that feeling of connection. Well, God had to teach me through a rigorous process of rejection over rejection that I don't need to build my value on what other people think, but the word of God. And when we can pass that test, then we're ready to receive things, because what we do won't be dependent on what people say about us, how people feel about us, what they tell others about us. Our life worth doesn't come from their opinions, like Marcus was saying. Our life worth comes from what God says. And sometimes that takes a process depending on how severe of a rejection that we deal with.
And the big issue is not knowing who you are in Christ, all right? That's where a lot of rejection comes from. Once you know who you are in Christ, one thing that I learned is what God has for me is for me.
Yeah.
So the friends that he has for me, the relationships that he has for me, nothing can take that away. So here's the dangerous thing. If you struggle with that rejection, one of the fruits of rejection is manipulation. And so you try to be manipulative to be accepted. But here's the problem. That's like the equivalent of Adam and Eve trying to dress themselves in fig leaves. You're going to get tired of it. Some people get in relationships being manipulative. You try to be what you think that person wants you to be accepted. The problem with that is when you build on that foundation, it's eventually going to collapse because you're going to get tired of hiding your real self. You're going to get tired of putting on that mask every morning. And this is why he whom the Son has set free is free indeed. God will liberate you and show you who you are. And I always tell people this, you shouldn't even be in a relationship with anybody until you know who you are in Christ. Man looks at the outward appearance, but God looks at the heart. You can manipulate your pastor, you can manipulate your wife and your husband and all these other people, but you cannot manipulate God. Mm. And the Bible says, they that worship must worship in spirit and in truth. I can try to look the part. I can try to look holy. I can try to look like a super Christian because I want to be accepted. I want the pastor to be like, yeah, that guy's holy. Yeah, that guy's anointed. Or even with family members and friends. But at the end of the day, even if you have the acceptance of the world, you can find yourself being rejected by God because you have not been authentic. You have not allowed God to do the surgery that needs to be done on your heart. My brothers and sisters, God wants to heal you from that rejection. He wants to heal you from those wounds. So you don't have to walk around being manipulative. You don't have to walk around being fake. God wants to make you into who exactly He created you to be. And for you to walk in that power, walk in that revelation, and walk in that authority. And when He sets you free, man, you won't ever let people's opinions be a prison for you anymore. You'll shake the dust off your feet because you know who you are and you know who God is to you. And if you don't remember anything else we said in this video, that's the biggest step. Getting over rejection by knowing who you are in Christ. And that only comes by spending time in His presence, spending time in His word, because He will transform your mind and He'll have you out there walking like David in confidence. If you're with me, cool. If you're not, that's fine, because what God has for me is for me.
Absolutely for me. Let's remind ourselves that God has placed such a high value on your life that He was willing to pay with His own blood. The Bible says that God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. God thought about you so much so that He was willing to die for your sins. He was willing to die to break that, to bring that connection back to a restored connection. God was willing to shed His blood so that you can be intimately reconnected with God. So there's no need for us to feel rejected when we think about what God has done for us. When we keep in mind the wonderful work of the cross, we can get this overwhelming sense of love. You can pass the rejection test by setting your focus on who God says that you are. God bless you. Yeah.